When negotiating getting paid, it's extremely important to put on the table those things necessary to have a negotiation, not just an agreement. Hi, this is Justin Hitt from Sustainable Wealth Secrets. If you've ever been in a situation where there's litigation, where one party believes they are owed something and the other party believes they're owed something else, it's always better to have a multi-point program so that you can set up a negotiation or settlement rather than simply a complete disagreement. And here's what I'm getting at. Whether it's a divorce, a selling or closing of a business, the removal of a partner, it's always better to have a prenuptial or a buy-sell agreement in advance so that you don't have to discuss or have any arguments at the end about who owes what. Now, at the end, if you do have a disagreement, it's better to put on the table several points rather than one big bundle. So here's an example. If there is a property settlement and you have rental properties and personal residence, you put the rental properties as several individual agreements and the resident as a separate agreement. That way it is a, do you agree or disagree? They either agree on the whole package, or you can negotiate each and every element before you move on to a final agreement. So you might get fortunate and they'll agree to everything, or they'll go point by point. Then when they go point by point, you can demonstrate that they're actually delaying the decision and causing unreasonable weight on the other party, and you'll more likely get a judge that will go ahead and bundle everything together and then close out that way. So I've seen cases where clients have had 30 or 40 rental properties. Instead of saying a rental property portfolio, they actually listed each and every rental property with its own cost basis, with its own details. Now, you're going to have to create this information anyway because the other party is going to ask for evidence. They're going to ask for transactions. They're going to ask for P&Ls. But this allows you to negotiate each individual property so that somebody ends up, you know, maybe they take 15 of the properties, you take 15 of the properties. You can bundle them up by neighborhoods if there's a lot of properties. But ultimately, it's like having an agreement with several points of consideration and negotiating each point. Until the point they either say mercy and roll it all up into one decision, or it gives you the opportunity to take things off the table or add things to the table. Now, I always present my agreements with the full picture. What would be the fairest to all parties involved, and what would be the big picture overview of what we're doing? It just basically put everything on the table. And then if the other person starts nitpicking or driving through the details, it really makes them look unreasonable. Because I've given you my best deal up front. You either take it or you don't. I know you want to negotiate, but I can take things off the table, but I'm not going to discount. I can change the agreement as we go. And ultimately, if you have to change the agreement, it gives you the opportunity to quid pro quo or to otherwise set up an opportunity where both parties can win. If you think somebody owes you $100,000, you make sure you got every detail to demonstrate the $100,000, but you also want to tack on the cost of gathering the paperwork, the legal fees, everything else that's involved, and you may end up being $200,000. And then you can negotiate. They say, look, you want me to pay $200,000, but I really only owe you $100,000. Great. Prove the difference. You know, prove that you owe me $100,000. They said, well, that's what we're talking about. No, prove that you owe me only $100,000. I say you owe $200,000 because of these fees, because of the cost, because of the legal, because of the headache, because of the frustration, because of all this stuff. Show me you owe me $100,000. So they show you they only owe you $100,000. Now you've just locked down the fact they owe you $100,000. So now you're more likely to get paid the $100,000 because they just proved to you that they owe you $100,000. Now, if they go in and prove that they owe you $150,000 because they concession on some of the fees and some of the legal expenses associated with the activity, maybe, for example, it comes up to $200,000, they deduct $50,000 in legal expenses from their side, and then ultimately pay you $150,000 on a note or on an exchange settlement, then you've gotten your original money plus the pain and suffering or frustration or whatever you want to call it on top of it. But you wouldn't go up and show them that they owe $100,000. You wouldn't prove to them they owe you $100,000 and leave it at that. You've got to have the full picture. Because a lot of times, and I found this out in my first business, a lot of times people will build up a bunch of work, then they will sue you and say they don't owe you the money. So I did a bunch of IT work for somebody, actually for quite a few people, and they turned around later and said, you didn't do the work. I said, well, look, I got evidence I did the work. You signed off the milestone agreements. So I would do a bit of work. They'd sign it off and do a little QA on it. And then they were supposed to be paying a check. They never paid the check, but the work was on a schedule. So I went back and did the work. Long story short is I ended up getting screwed. And you don't need to get screwed. You need to have, again, multiple steps in which there's agreements on individual steps. So here are the 10 points I present before you. If you can't accept all 10, which do you accept? So you're going to take things off the table by getting an agreement with them. Which things do you reject? And they reject certain things. Now you know where you stand. Now, I know this is pretty complex and it can be difficult. I actually have a program called Getting Paid Fast. And it's about some of the different ways that you can set up a project or set up a negotiation so that you're more likely to get most of what you are looking for, rather than nothing, which happens in a lot of cases. Frankly, I had a client owed me about $360,000. I went after a lot of that money. I got $20,000 here, $10,000 there. But this one client owed me about $110,000. I actually got $1,500 out of it. And here's what happened. I had all the paperwork right. I had invoiced them. I had gone through and negotiated with them that the work was actually done. So I got signed agreements that the work was done. Well, I ended up taking them to the district court because of the size of the amount of money I was suing them for. I had to go to district court. So I go to district court and guess what they did? They countersued me. So they countersued me, requested I give them itemized invoices. So I'd go through my system and get them itemized invoices. They also requested timesheets. Now, what they were able to find in this is that some of my employees were actually committing fraud. So some of my employees were falsifying timesheets, and we were charging the customer for money that for time that it didn't actually spend. Now, they got the end result they were looking for, but they were charged for time that wasn't specific. Now, the contracts were project-based. They weren't paying for hours. They were paying for jobs. And at the time, they agreed to the invoice and signed the invoices, which I had on file. But ultimately, by taking the larger request, so I had sued them for like $110,000 or something like that. I only sued them for what I owed them. I didn't know half of what I know today. This was back in the 90s. They basically took that and broke it into like thousands of little parts. Okay. Now, what this did is when they found the timesheets of employees that had falsified their time, meaning they said they were on the customer site at a certain time and they weren't actually on the customer site, and the customer could prove they weren't on the customer site, that it just made it questionable, made everything else questionable. A long story short is they'd start knocking off invoices. Now, to this point, I had actually sent them to Dun & Bradstreet and they had lost their homes. They had lost their vehicles. A lot of their loans got called in. So to be fair, I kind of deserve them coming back at me this way. But basically, it made things questionable and we ended up settling on $1,500. They cut me a check for $1,500 for this $110,000 they owed me because they did the same thing I just described to you. They took the larger $110,000 that was owed and they built out what's called a composition. What does that consist of? What is the composition of that $110,000? Then they took each invoice that was in question and they broke it out again. What was the composition of that invoice? What was the basis for here? And I showed them, I said, look, this invoice, you owe it because you signed off here that the work was complete. Well, that wasn't enough. Because once they found that a couple employees were doing poor timesheets, they used requests for information, different types of ways to get me to provide additional details. I didn't know any better. I could have provided summaries. I could have did other things. I didn't know, but that's how powerful this technique is. It got them out of $110,000 in debt. And now again, they got work. They got the results that they were looking for. They hired me. I performed the work. The work was performed well. My team performed the work well. They're just my employees were padding timesheets. Now, even when the invoice was not based on a timesheet, Those timesheets were primarily for me to pay my employees. They were still able to get out of the payment by taking that bigger chunk, breaking it out into many different individual parts, and then breaking those parts down even more and being able to question the line items, being able to go in and say, hey, look, we agree on this, but we can't prove this guy was here on this day. So he probably wasn't there. Show me your records. Show me what's going on here. Show me that he actually went to that site. And I didn't have very good paperwork. And I didn't know that he actually had gone to the site. For all I know, he could have gone near the site and done something else. I could argue that the invoices were project based, and here's the agreement. Here's the project base. Here's the signature that the project, that chunk of work was done like it was supposed to. But they were still able to put into question the cost of materials. Now, if I had in the contract that it was a cost plus, or I had in the contract that they were paying hourly rates, or that they were not, that it was a project based work, I might have had a better leg to stand on because I had poor contracts. But ultimately, folks, what I'm describing here is that if you have a disagreement about how much is owed, or a disagreement about how much you should pay, or you don't even like a sales invoice, you want to, or an estimate, you want to break it down into its component parts. You want to justify each part. You want to go in and make sure that you're paying for what you got. You also want to make sure that things settle on the individual agreement. So in the case of a divorce, you want to make sure that each property, each condition, each objection you have, child support is a separate argument than the settlement of the house. The settlement of retirement accounts and 401ks and such is a separate argument with each 401k, Roth IRA, everything is its separate page. Now, a good lawyer is going to bind all this into a big binder, and it's going to make it easier for you and the lawyer to sit down and discuss the points. It does make it easier for you to collect, but ultimately it gives a nice orderly package for the lawyers to go through. The best position you can get in is when both lawyers work for you. Now, listen carefully what I mean by this, because this is combining a little bit of strategic relationships. In the case of building wealth, you want your opponent's lawyer working for you as well. So you bring it to the table with a fair deal, and you negotiate each point. And you have transparency, it's highly organized, and then when you sit down and go through these line items, you can say, do you agree or disagree? Okay, if you disagree, what do you disagree about? Let's set that down. And eventually you get to the point where people just say, look, it makes sense, let's go with it. And it works well in all parties this way. It also works well if the other party is being a pain in the ass. But ultimately, it's very structured. It's very organized. Now, it doesn't have to look that way to the other person. You can give them a big pile of stuff. You can have supporting documents, thousands of supporting documents. You can ultimately make it overwhelming. You can request information from them, like happened to me in the past a number of times. But ultimately, when it goes in front of a judge, the judge will understand it. The judge will see the back and forth. For example, you can use a timeline in the beginning of the document to show the timeline of going back and forth on this. You can show any preliminary agreements up front in a document. Then you can have the supporting materials in the back. But ultimately, again, you're more likely to get paid by having it all nice and neat, nice and organized, but line item. Now, you could, in the case of invoicing, have a packaged invoice and the line items you don't provide to the other individual. But again, you always want to have these things here. It's a project management methodology. It's a procurement management methodology that helps you know that your costs are right and they're properly categorized, that your invoices have gone out as they should, and that you are most likely to get paid. I'm Justin Hitt with Sustainable Wealth Secrets. You can visit us at www.sustainablewealthsecrets. If you have any questions about building wealth, about getting paid, about creating and producing opportunities for yourself or your business, you want to visit us at www.sustainablewealthsecrets.com, where we help you transform business relationships into profits guaranteed. And we've just covered a quick rundown on negotiations in the context of you getting paid. I got a complete program on this. Just simply write our offices and ask your questions. Thanks for listening.